know.
Hey, good morning, good morning. You're in the right place.
I could miss them one by one.
I think you'll make it.
She would still be gone. Her eyes are blue, her hair is long. At 64, she was born in Baton Rouge. Her favorite song was In My Life. I memorized her every move. I knew her books, her car, her clothes.
Saturdays, where we're at the island.
But I paid no attention to her.
So you did good. Thank you.
She never said. When she cried, I turned my head.
All right, as we come into worship, we celebrate the joy of infant baptism. Let's stand for the ringing of the bell to call us into worship today. Amen. And you please be seated. I want to lift up some announcements. First of all, this week we have a wonderful youth event going on. On Monday, our youth will be kayaking on Rice Lake. So note that. And if you haven't signed up, make sure you do, because Kiri has to get the right number of kayaks. She's at Leech Lake away today, but she has to make sure she has the right number of kayaks. Also, small group recovery will be going on. I will be out of town. My cell phone is available. I'll be on vacation for about a week and a half. But there's lots of things going on. There's a finance meeting too. Just make note, take advantage of ministry. Want to lift up a baptism today. We celebrate the covenant of infant baptism always. David and Natalie, their daughter Lily Ann, is she sleeping yet or is she not? No, she's there. She's awake. Okay, well, it's nice to have her here. All right, we celebrate that also. Before we do that, before we move into a message and the takeaway of that, let's celebrate a call to worship. Today, the call to worship is from the New Testament book of Philippians. We've been doing a series on being anxious and anxiety. And Paul writes from a Roman prison in his retirement years, "Focus and meditate on these things." Let's stand and join together for the call to worship. And I will begin. Paul writes from a Roman prison to us. "Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, keep on doing the thoughts that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me. The God of peace will be with you." Amen, and please be seated. Amen. As we continue to worship, I always want to lift up prayer. Our prayer bookmarker is always on our webpage. Know that. You can get it updated. We've been dealing with loss of family members, some friends, and just the ministry of funerals. And just know that and lift these families in prayer. Let us continue to worship and just join me as we celebrate the power of prayer in the prayer bookmarker. Here we go. Gracious Lord, we come before you today because your love is real. And we get that, Lord, and we know that, and we are in your house. And so, Lord, as we celebrate your love today, let's begin with the grace that you give us. Let's begin with grace that is greater than any earthly limitation. Let's begin with the fact that you're the Son of the living God. And through that, Lord, Emmanuel, you were willing to become human. And because of that, you understand us. You understand us when we're anxious. You understand us with anxiety. You suffered it as the Son of God in human form. And then you took it to a level that we never did. You took it to the cross. And you took it there and you gave us life eternal. Lord, we just give you thanks for that as the Son of God. And that's the name we come to pray in. Jesus' name. Then you give us the wisdom of the Holy Spirit. We pray with that also, Lord, and we thank you for that. And as we come to you in prayer, Lord, we lift up the request to you. We lift up the need for healing, physically and emotionally. The names on our prayer bookmarker, the names on our hearts and ourselves also. And we pray for healing in Jesus' name, physically and emotionally. Lord, we lift up the fact that we are in the midst of a pandemic, the midst of a virus. Lift up those on the front line, especially those, Lord, that are trying to find the antidote. Bless them. Let their skills shine because we need it. And so we lift that to you, Lord. We lift up our mission statement to you, Lord. May we introduce people to Christ. Help them grow in Christ, Lord. And also, Lord, may we just continue to enable others to do the same thing. Help us be that with skin on. Help the mission statement be more than just a writing on the wall. Help us be a part of our daily lives in Jesus' name. And Lord, as we come to you, we pray for our leaders, our president, to our local government, some of our own. We are a divided nation, and we need you. We are a nation that is polarized, and we need you. We are a nation that needs to come together in prayer. And so let us pray for our leaders. Do we agree or disagree? Yeah, Lord, that's going to be constant. But we can still pray for our leaders. And so we lift them up in Jesus' name. Lord, we also pray for the men and women that are serving in our military, the names listed on our prayer bookmarker, their family members, their spouses. We thank you for their willingness to serve. Let them know our gratitude, Lord. We also pray for their safety. And so we lift them up. We lift their family members, their spouses to you. Places like San Antonio, Texas. Places like Germany. The Carolinas, Lord. And people serving in the reserves. We just lift them up in Jesus' name. And Lord, as a church, as a ministry, each day we take that covenant of prayer for our firefighters, our law enforcement, our medical responders, their spouses, their children. Some of them are on duty right now, Lord. Bless them because when we need them, they're there. And we thank you for them. We lift them up. We lift their spouses and their children up. And we thank you for their willingness to serve in Jesus' name every day, Lord. Lord, as we come to you to worship today, help us hear the Holy Spirit. Help us be fed. Help it not be just a routine of religious habit, but help us open up to your grace, Holy Spirit. And so, to do that, Lord, we pray that prayer that has withstood all viruses, withstood all time. We know it as the Lord's Prayer. And so with the words on the screen, let's pray it out loud together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. 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 As we move to a time of scripture reading today, I'm going to invite Deanna to come forward. We are in the midst of a sermon series on being anxious and anxiety. We're on the last Sunday of that. Next Sunday, Carrie's going to be preaching. But we just lift up what to meditate on, as in our call to worship. In the midst of that, meditating on all those things that are honorable, we look at a story of a woman who's been bleeding for 12 years, severe bleeding. And she's been to the Mayo Clinic, she's been to Johns Hopkins University, she's been to the University of Minnesota, and she's getting worse. And so we're going to lift that story up as she understands the importance of meditating on Christ.
The reading today is from Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 25.
And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and had spent all she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and touched his cloak, because she thought, if I touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped, and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had gone out from him. He turned around in the crowd and asked, who touched my clothes? You see the people crowding against you, his disciples answered, and yet you can ask, who touched me? But Jesus kept looking around to see who had done it. Then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet, and trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. He said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. Here ends the reading of God's word.
Amen, and thanks be to God for the power of God's word. Thank you, Deanna. As we look at this one more message, we've been looking at being anxious and having anxiety, and that just fills our life, and looking at what that means. One more message. Today, the call to worship from Paul in a Roman prison, spending out his retirement, his pension there. He tells us, if you remember, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, focus on these things. And we live in a world where it's very, very difficult to find the discipline and the tools to focus, to meditate on those things. I want us to think about that as we move into one more message before Carrie shares a story on serving next Sunday, and just things like that. But now, just join me in prayer. Lord, we need to focus, and it's hard to do that at times. We just admit that. There's a lot of things that grab at us. And in the midst of being anxious, Lord, in the midst of anxiety, just help us with that. And so as we do that, Lord, we just ask for the power of your Holy Spirit, wrapped in your grace. And we do that and ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. So, many, many years ago, I'm talking 1999. Some of you can remember that. Some of you have no idea what 1999 was like. But my wife and I bought an SUV, our first ever. It was our second vehicle. We were young in ministry, and it came with what was then, maybe I'll take a picture of it on Google, but it came with what was then was a car phone. It had a car phone in your, you know what, in the dashboard of it, an antenna for it. We got to look at it and use it. And we paid $35 a month to use it. And Kelly thought it would be nice, because then she would know, you know, whether I'm coming home at night from a visit, out in a snowstorm and things like that. And so we got that. Then, of course, times began to change. And we got introduced to cell phones. Back then, they were analog cell phones, and you just signed up for them. You paid $45 a month. And then we got our first flip phone. Those things were amazing. And then, yeah, and then we got on the internet. And now we all have smartphones and iPhones and all of those wonderful things. And over the years, Facebook has been popular, and Instagram, and all the other stuff we're on that I don't even know about. I'm just kind of a Facebook guy. And those phones, those little things, man, they can do everything, can't they? You can get on Google. You can punch your address in. It connects right to the screen of my truck. And then you get where you want to go. You don't need, back in the day, they used to have plot maps. And you'd look at those plot maps, and you'd find out where people lived in the country. You don't even know what those are, probably. You can Google it. But anyway, now you just have a direction thing on your phone. You can find out how much things cost before you get to the store and actually pay for it, get the best deal. You can get all your airlines, everything, reservations, hotels, everything on your smartphone or your iPhone, the weather, the radar. When we had the storms come through on Friday, you could just watch the cells go right south of Painesville and almost pinpoint where there were some dangerous spots going on. The problem with these smartphones and these iPhones, and this is really is one of the problems. The problem is, I think I got the wrong wire here, but that's life today. We'll make it work. The problem is they become our best friends. And the last thing we want is to live in a world that isolates us so much. My phone's in my office because I don't want it going off while I'm preaching. But the last thing that we want is to isolate ourselves so much that our phone becomes our closest friend. We live in a world where Facebook and Instagram and all of that gets us so isolated, we live for the moment when we can post a picture that makes us better than the last picture that was on Facebook. They got all the hits. We live in a world where we want to isolate ourselves so Facebook makes us look the best. And then there's other things about that too. Commercials, social media has just popped up. If we buy this vehicle, our lives will get taken care of. We will get everything we want if we buy this vehicle. Well, we don't have enough money. That's okay. Just do it on credit. Volkswagen right now, they're doing something quite amazing. I think it's ridiculous. But Volkswagen company, the car company Volkswagen, you can buy their vehicle, but you don't have to pay for it for 6 years. Yeah, now you just think about the irony of that. You buy a brand new vehicle, you don't pay it for it for 6 years as a gimmick. You know, that car is getting old, and it's getting older, and then you start paying after 6 years. You still got to pay the price you paid when you paid for it. You know, bought it at list price. This is not good stuff. And this is the world we live in. And then this guy in a Roman prison, he tells us, meditate on these things, whatever is pure, whatever is honorable. And he's doing that from a Roman prison. Listen to what Paul writes as he writes the church of Philippi and he writes us. This is crazy stuff. Whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing. I can hardly remember these things. Whatever is commendable, if there's any excellence, if there's anything worthy of praise, think about these things. This is amazing stuff, and this is really, really hard to do when you have your iPhones, your smartphones, Facebook, social media. This is hard stuff to live. So let's just dive into that story, and I believe that actually happened, I really do, that Deanna read about a woman who's been bleeding for how many years? 12 years, it says. And how does she focus on this stuff, and what can we learn from that? The first thing we need to realize is our brain, our soul, our brain and our heart connecting. We can allow what we want in our airspace. You know, if you're an air traffic controller or you know one, they control what goes into the airspace. They tell jets to go one way or another, so they only allow a certain amount of flight patterns to happen. The real question is, what do we allow around our airspace of our lives? And that takes discipline. Sometimes, if you're like me, we let things in that we should not let in, and we have to remind ourselves of Paul from a Roman prison. Is that honorable? Is that true? Is it praiseworthy? Is it commendable? And this lady, she's endured a lot of sick things in her airspace. She's been bleeding for 12 years. She's been everywhere with all of her money spent. She's been to the Mayo Clinic. She's been to John Hopkins. She's been to the University of Minnesota and other places and specialists. And instead of getting better, if you read Deanna Red, she's only getting worse. She had endured much under many physicians. She had spent all that she had, and she was no better, but she grew worse. And because of Jewish law and custom, she was also leperized. She was an outcast. She was untouchable. She was seen as unclean. They would not let her into crowds. We have a day where we have the mask, we have to social distance. She couldn't be anywhere. In order to touch Jesus, she had to risk her life, because once she did that, once she fought herself through the crowd, she was liable for being stoned to death by Jewish law. So she was really going after it. She had thrown everything she had into this one last chance. And she was allowing in her airflight, in her flight pattern, in her airways, what was she was permitting? I'm going to risk it all just so I can be next to Jesus. Just so I can touch him. Remember, after she was healed, her problems weren't solved. Her bleeding had stopped, and her physical healing had stopped. But she was still going to walk away leprized by the community. Communities don't change their mind on a person just because they're healed. I can testify to that personally. I think of people in recovery. I think of even my own life before I gave my life to Christ and how people wonder, well, let's just see if it's real or not. She still had all that social stuff to deal with. But what did she do? She wondered, what am I going to let into my life? And how am I going to fix my thoughts on that? What are we going to let land? We want to get rid of being anxious. We want to get rid of being anxiety. We're not going to get rid of it all the time. We're going to have times where we're anxious. We're going to have times of anxiety. But what am I going to let land? What am I going to fix my thoughts on? And so she fought her way through the crowd. She was probably pushed away. She was probably threatened. She was probably told, if you do this again, we will put you up for stoning. And she got to Jesus. And she had enough faith that day to just touch his cloak. What am I going to let land in my life? How am I going to focus on how I work through the middle of being anxious, the middle of anxiety? You know, the interesting thing about this passage, there's a lady that's a daughter of an official, a very wealthy official in the community this lady lived in. That daughter's name was Darius. Jesus was asked by that official to go to his house so Jesus could heal that official's daughter, Darius. And Jesus went there because he had that clout. And on his way to that official's house, this outcast leper comes and fights her way through the crowd because her thoughts are fixed on Jesus in the midst. Think how anxious she was. Think of her anxiety fighting through that crowd. And did her problems stop? No, she was healed. And I think, and honestly, she wasn't just physically healed. I think her faith was also changed forever. But she still knew she had to fight the socialization that was awaiting her after being healed. But she did it anyway. She went there. When we think about what we fix our thoughts on, we have to seriously consider what we let in our area of our life and how we block it off what we need to. On Monday mornings, I come in and I get my week laid out, or Sunday nights, I start looking at the scripture for next week on Sunday night, Monday morning. I start planning that all out. All the stuff that goes on, the small group meetings, the leadership meetings, visitations needed, people I need to visit, all of that stuff. We all do that. And then I look at Friday. In case you don't know, Friday's my day off. And in the summer, you know, I look out 4 or 5 days ahead and out in the forecast because I want to know, is it going to be sunny on Friday or not? And it's only Monday morning, remember. Yeah, and I look out that 5-day forecast, and it says it's going to rain on Friday. And what do I do right away? How do I fix my thought? I think, oh, man, why even take the day off? They're calling for rain all day. They can't even predict the weather 24 hours out. But I start filling my mind with anxiety. And the truth of the matter is, as we get to Friday, the rain moves to Saturday or it moves to Thursday. What do we fix our thoughts on? Finally, how do we stay attached to that thought? How do we stay attached? That's the key. You know, the only one that made a public confession that day in that village, it wasn't the official's daughter, Darius, and she was healed too. It was an outcast woman who had been leprized, who they thought in society was going to bleed the rest of her life. and yet she made a confession publicly that she believed in Jesus as her Savior. We deal with anxiousness. We deal with anxiety all the time. You know, Jesus did also. He did. He went to the Garden of Gethsemane Thursday night before he was arrested. He went to the Garden of Gethsemane before he was going to be put on a cross and die. And he got there and he prayed that evening in that garden, and he, in anxious anxiety, said, "Father, if possible, take this cup from me." He's talking about the cross. "I don't know if I want to go through it. I'm scared." And then the next part of that prayer, "Not my will, but your will." And then he sweat tears of blood. Tears of blood. Doctors will tell you that people who have been involved in huge firefights in a war area, I mean a very, very nasty place, bullets and everything else flying over the top of you, people who are in those situations, military men especially, they will get so anxious they could sweat tears of blood. Jesus was there that night. He knows what it's like. He understands what we fight to permit to land in our airspace, to land in our mind, to land in our soul. And Jesus looks amongst the crowd and he says, "Who touched me?" Because he knew a power of healing had gone out of him. And the disciples, in the midst of being anxious and anxiety, you see the crowd. You see everybody here. How do we know who touched you? How do we stay attached? We get closer to Jesus. We get closer. We cry out for him. We ask for him. And we say we need him. It helps. I'm serious. You want Jesus? Pray. Cry out. He's there. He's waiting. He's free will. He won't help us unless we ask. And that lady risked it all. And she dove through that crowd. And she made a public confession. And what did Jesus say to her? "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Folks, we have looked at being anxious. We have looked at anxiety for several Sundays. For some of us, it's our first Sunday here. But what we need to remember is, how are we going to do what Paul said? We fix our thoughts on that. We're not going to be perfect. God is a God of grace. Our thoughts are not going to be the same all the time. We're going to have airspace that we should never have let land. But when we fix our thoughts on that, we can be like that woman. We can stay attached to God. We can make our way through a world that separates us even more with technology. And we can find ourselves with God. We can stay attached to that. So I just lift that up to you. I lift that up to you. I'm going to ask Del and Paula to come up, and they're going to give us some music today as we have a time in prayer. It's entitled "You Are Holy." It's a newer version of it. But it's time to just say, what do I let land? And it's not out of guilt. Don't do that. It's out of grace. And how can I fix myself like Paul did from that Roman prison? How can a guy from a Roman prison, because of his faith, write the Church of Philippi, the book of Philippians, and write us, whatever is honorable, whatever is pure? All of that. And how do we fix our thoughts on that? How do we protect ourselves from letting other things land in our airspace and stay attached to our Savior? You are holy. Just spend some time in prayer.
Fill the temple, the angels circle. me, for I'm unclean, for my eyes have seen the Holy King, and it cleansed my lips right before my eyes, and the pillars shook as the angels cried. You are holy, oh so holy. You are holy, Lord, oh.
Just with that soft music in the background, let's just spend some time in prayer. Gracious Lord, we know that all of us, myself included, we let some of those things land in our airspace that we just shouldn't have. It takes us away from humble. It takes us away from holiness. It takes us away from what is good. And we're there. It's not that we're guilty of it. We are, but it's not that you want us to be judged about it. We just admit it. Let us be like that woman to stay attached to you, Lord. Just touch your cloak with our mess. Just touch your cloak with our isolation and our anxiousness and our anxiety, Lord. And wrap it in your grace and stay attached to you. Help us understand that this week, Lord. Help us understand that today as we celebrate infant baptism, as we're in our homes listening to this, as we're in our living rooms. Help us understand that, Lord. Because the truth is, if we just stay attached to you, holiness will fill our airspace and anxious and anxiety will be pushed out. It's not going to solve everything right away, but you are holy. We want to be in your airspace. So we just lift that up, Lord, in Jesus' name. Holy Spirit, amen. 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 All right. Well, we're also going to have a response today with the celebration of infant baptism. So I'm going to ask Mom and Dad and Lillian and the godparents to come on up. And we're going to celebrate that today as a family and as a community. I think Lily took a nap. Yeah. Now you guys, I'll give you that. Well, you can look at the screen too, but here, I'll give you that. All right. God. David and Natalie, come on over here if you would. Thank you. I'll give you this. All right. You got your hands full, Dad, okay? So I have met with David and Natalie a few times as we have come up to this moment. And we've talked about what this means, but it's not just about them. It's about the godparents. It's about us as a congregation. It's about all of us just making this commitment and being here. And as I asked them some questions, we've gone over this. I won't test you. We've been over this. You're well aware. This is not a test. But I ask you, as you make this public confession, but before I do that, I remind us Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me. They are of most importance in the kingdom of heaven." And then he went on to say, "Unless you trust God like a child trusts a parent, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven." That's a real good symbol. That's a real good symbol. And so I ask Mom and Dad, on behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, please say, "I do." And so then, do you, Mom and Dad, do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, please say, "I do." And finally, one of the most important ones, Mom and Dad, do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior with a capital S? Put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord with a capital L. In union with the church in Christ that has opened to people of all ages, all nations, and all races, if so, please say, "I do." And because of your commitment to Lily Ann Hazel, I ask you, Mom and Dad, will you nurture Lily Ann in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example, she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself and profess her faith openly and to lead a Christian life? If so, please say, "I do." Amen. And now to the godparents, Ashley and Nate, you're here because Lily Ann is going to want to go somewhere for a weekend, and Mom and Dad are going to want her to stay maybe a week when she gets to her teen years. All right? And you're making this commitment as well as us as a congregation, surrounded in grace. I ask you, to the godparents, will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include Lily Ann now before you in your care? And how do you respond? With God's help, we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround Lily Ann with a community of love and forgiveness, that she may grow in her grace to others. We will pray for Lily Ann, that she may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to Christ as her Savior. Amen. Amen. I'm going to put this aside here. This water, it symbolizes what we call prevenient grace and the power of the Holy Spirit. We've had some warm days this summer, and there's been days full of humidity and heat, and we just want to jump into that lake, wherever it may be, because we want, or that pool, and we want to cool off. And the water symbolizes that symbol. It purifies us. Lily Ann is too young to know any different, but someday she's going to get older and she's going to choose, "Do I want Christ as my Savior?" And that prevenient grace in all of us helps her understand that. But yet, we got to play a role in that commitment. Mom and Dad are not here to do this on their own. We want to be that witness. And so as we do that, as we celebrate, let's do that in prayer. Lord, we come before you today because we need your grace, all of us, myself included. There was a time, Lord, before I asked you into my heart, that I was gifted with your prevenient grace. I didn't know it at the time, but you did it anyway. Help us understand that, Lord, and help us understand that in such a way that we want Lily Ann to choose you as Savior someday. We want to help Mom and Dad with this commitment. And so we celebrate that with your grace, now and forever. Holy Spirit, just pour it out. Help us be open to it. And we lift up Mom and Dad to you and Lily Ann and family in Jesus' name, Holy Spirit. Amen. All right. Lily, would you be able to come with me for a little bit? Would you be willing to? Oh, thank you. All right. Yeah, hang in there. Whoop. You want that back? Would you like that back? There you go. Lily Ann Hazel Hudson, I baptize you in the name of God Almighty, Jesus Christ, God's only Son, and the power of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, amen. Let's go take a walk if you're interested, okay? You hang in there. You see all these people here? They're here for you. There's your brother. He's here for you. All of them are here for you because they want to help you find Jesus. Someday, I'm going to ask you to go to ski camp with me when you get older. Okay? We'll work on that later. And Del and Paula might want you to play a guitar with them someday. Yeah. And I think you know these people too. You're kind of related to them, all right? They're going to help you. All of them. See, they're here. Someday you're going to come to Wednesday night service and Wednesday night ministry, starting with elementary, then go to middle school and high school. All right? Now here's Bonnie. Now she likes the Packers, but that's okay. All right? She'll teach you to be nice to the Packers. We try. Okay? All these people are here for you, and you've been really good, so thank you. I think I'm going to bring you back to Mom and Dad here because you've been so good for me. Here you go, Dad. I'm going to put you right back with Dad. You're going to know him and recognize him. So as we continue, I want to involve us as a congregation also. So as we look at the screens, this is not just liturgy to be read. This is part of our commitment. This is why we do Wednesday night ministry, Wednesday afternoon. This is why we launch a service for Wednesday night. This is why we have camping ministry. This is why Bruce goes fishing and we support that camp, Vacation Bible School. So I ask you, members of the household of God, I commend Lillianne to your love and care and do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. And how do you respond? We give thanks for all that God has already given Lillianne and welcome her in Christian love. As members together with Lillianne in the body of Christ in this congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified in Jesus Christ. Amen. Mom and Dad, before you go, here is a certificate of baptism and a Bible for Lillianne as she goes to bed at night. And a rose just to remember that. Wow, you're pretty good. I was going to give it to the godparents, but you got that. You want me to give it over there and they can bring it to you? A rose just to remember this day. Now, as we leave, I always like to give thanks, but not to us, not to the parents, but we give thanks for this sacramental moment to God. So let's do that. Amen. Amen. All right, you can be seated. The brother didn't get part of it. He wants a little more. That's all right. Well, what's the first name that you learn as a parent? Grace. All right, folks. And now I'm going to give the closing charge from the back. In the midst of a world that is anxious, in the midst of a world that has anxiety, let's fix our attachment to God, Jesus Christ, God's only Son, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen and thank you.